anyone can be an entrepreneur. Great risk can often lead to great reward.
Hi, I'm Dr. D from Dr. D University, also known as Dr. Duncan Pelly. And we are so lucky to have with us today, Sara Frasca. A lot of my international audience may be unfamiliar with you and some of the work that you do. So please tell us about yourself and the businesses that you're affiliated with.
Thank you, Dr. D. Thank you for having me. So I am an innovation keynote speaker. I have talked all over the world trying to help really harness the creativity that lays dormant in individuals, teams, and in organizations, helping to motivate them to think differently, to really drive growth through opening up new possibilities. So that's one part of my world. The second part of my world, which is a little bit unique and unusual, is that I opened a restaurant about 6 years ago. So I'm carrying on my family's legacy. I'm the third generation to serve the sandwich that my grandmother invented. And so that's been pretty fun. And then the third thing, I know this is crazy, but I just started a new business in the last, couple months here, and it's called Fireproof. And it's a business consulting firm that helps, and we're really focused on law firms right now, but I think it'll be broader than just law firms in the future. We're really helping to try to drive accountability, alignment within an organization, a really clear focus on data so that people can make the best decisions possible, and also be as profitable as possible, and a mixture of different components of marketing, etc. So there's, you know, my Sara Frasca brand, which is my innovation component, my Trasca and Company Eatery, which is my restaurant, and then the last one, which I mentioned, which is Fireproof. So I've got a lot going on, but all three are super fun.
Well, you know, you successfully managed, it sounds like, a really interesting series of enterprises. How do you kind of juggle everything and manage your time effectively?
Well, that's a great question. I also have five children, so I know that'll shock everyone, but I have a really great husband. I would say, you know, starting there, I truly believe that the partnership we've developed to care for our family, care for everything in our world, has been instrumental in allowing me to do all these different things. The next thing I would say is that I view my career as a marathon and not a sprint. I think I've been able to do things along the way that I believe, you know, will add up to greatness at some point. It may not come to fruition for a while. So one of those is the restaurant. I have always looked at it as it's not a money-making scheme. It's a terrible industry. If someone wants to make $1 million, it's really terrible for that. But it allows me to bring my family's legacy to the surface, which I mentioned. And it is going to be a very long road to the success that I hope to have someday. So I choose things like having higher quality ingredients. I choose having a better service model, which of course, you know, makes my margins slimmer and slimmer than if I was a corporate chain or, you know. But I've chosen that very specifically. And again, I think of it as a long, you know, a long game and not just the short-term ROI. So having a great partner, having a little bit of, you know, the mindset that will help me to get to my eventual goals and knowing that it's a marathon and not a sprint. Those are kind of two of the biggest parts that help me have balance.
Well, here's a question that a lot of my young female students always ask. And it's, have you ever felt like there are certain obstacles that you face that maybe a man wouldn't have had to face, or vice versa? Do you think that being a lady was an advantage in some way?
So I would say both are true. I'll tell you, my background is from the corporate America type world. So I was at General Mills for about 15 years, and I would find myself in boardrooms all over the country. I was in shopper marketing, and I would meet with boardrooms full of white middle-aged men. And it was pretty funny because I was the only female in the room. I was a lot younger than them, and I was in charge of convincing them that, you know, our brands had power, and one specific brand, which was called the Box Tops for Education platform. So I would sit in this room and I would talk to all of these men who had no idea what Box Tops was. And I would say, call your wife. And they would laugh because they would say then, oh, that's that thing that my wife makes me tear the cupboard apart, right? And they would eventually start to come around, and we were very successful with this program. But, you know, I think there are some aspects that I've had to really, you know, kind of challenge myself. I have had, you know, moments where I've been very nervous walking into a room and being the only female. And I've always had that kind of competitive philosophy that I will never let them see me sweat, right? I'm going to act like this is what I do every single day. And in that fake it till you make it philosophy, I eventually got very comfortable with it. And I took it on as a challenge that it was fun for me. It's fun for me to be the only, you know, female in the room or the youngest person in the room, because I'm going to show them, you know, the tools that I have, this great breadth of experience, and I'm going to turn it into a positive and knock their socks off. They'll never believe how this, you know, younger female, whatever, you know, was able to bring to the table. So I think I've always taken that on as a challenge. I definitely also believe that it is a pro. And, you know, I have had a lot of strong female leaders in my day that have, you know, I have been my bosses, or I have tried to emulate. And I think that, you know, there's certainly, it's a generalization to say that, you know, women have more empathy or just a little bit better service-minded, you know, philosophies. But I have found that the women that I tend to naturally gravitate towards have that philosophy. They have a servant leadership mindset. They have the ability to serve first, serve with their warmth, whether it's their team, their clients, their customers, etc. So, you know, I had a natural affinity to, again, watch and learn from these women and take on some of those characteristics that, again, I believe to be, you know, very much pros in the work that I do in the world.
So you've traveled a fair amount, you said, around the United States and also the world. Did I catch that?
Yes, that's right.
So are there any locations where it's like, wow, this is really the best place to start a business, or, oh my goodness, this is the worst place to start a business? And why did you think that?
That's a great question. I would say, you know, I really do have kind of that American dream spirit in me. So I think my natural answer would be, why not here? Why not in the U.S.? My grandparents were entrepreneurs. My parents were entrepreneurs. And I have always felt like, you know, we have this ability to make the world what we want it to be. And so I think that that kind of American entrepreneurism is alive and well in me. I coach a lot of, you know, younger folks and upper education or higher education students and classes where I can help to kind of impart that wisdom on them, right? I mean, this restaurant industry is the grittiest place you can imagine. And by grit, I just mean it takes that tenacious spirit. It takes someone who is willing to do whatever it takes to survive. And I feel like I've seen firsthand, especially with the restaurant, what it looks like to have the possibility that you will not make payroll. And it changes you like you can't believe, right? I mean, sitting in corporate America, sitting in big brands, I mean, you never have that survival mentality. I get goosebumps when I think about it. It's incredibly powerful to feel as though you are the only way that business will survive. And therefore, I think, you know, it allows you to see things in a different light. It allows you to have that tenacity, that fierceness, that persistence that I think makes, you know, America and the American dream so great. So if I was going to answer it, I probably would say America. Now, that said, I've never launched a business elsewhere, so I can't say that, you know, there's a bad place. I just have only done it here. So I have found it to be an amazing experience.
Now, you said you coached a lot of people on, you know, secondary education and stuff. You've probably seen a lot of different things that entrepreneurs are doing. Is there a piece of advice that you could offer young entrepreneurs?
Well, yes, I would say, you know, a lot of folks are following passions, or they are driven to do, you know, to solve a challenge. And I think that is great. But what I would coach people, and what I have coached people, is that they have to also be willing to pivot. When I've seen people fail the most, it's when they are so tunnel visioned, they're so committed to a particular idea or ideal or solution that they're not willing to see a broader sphere of possibilities. So this is where kind of my innovation coaching comes in. I would say if we start with our solution or start with the problem at hand, there are many ways to solve the problem. We have to have the passion for the problem, not the passion for the solution, meaning that if they can find, you know, something that they want to do, they want to help kids, or they want to reduce food waste in the world. I'm making this up, but that's the problem. That's what they need to be passionate about. It might come to life in a technological solution. It might come to life in a, you know, I don't even know, a satellite-based system. I have no idea, but it could come to life in a way that they would never have expected. But having that openness to see other possibilities is what I think allows people to find the most success.
Did you write a business plan? And if you did, when did you write it? And did you find the exercise helpful?
Well, I would always recommend kind of having that pre-planning. I would say, you know, I wasn't a business major. I didn't take a lot of economics courses. I didn't really have the background. So for me, the business plan was that research, right? It was almost like I needed to go back to understanding all of the different components. And I ended up actually for the restaurant applying for an SBA loan. So that is a part of their process. So I was forced into it. I think it was an excellent way for me to understand kind of how they would need to see things. Luckily for me, it only took one pitch. I felt like I was very prepared. And so I would recommend it. It took me years. I probably planned my restaurant for about 12 years. That included saving money. That included coming up with ideas, kind of how I wanted to market, what I wanted the brand to look like, all of those different components. So then when I was able to finally synthesize it into a, I would say, fairly concise business plan, it really started to have kind of legs. It really started to come together for me. So I would recommend the process. I don't think it's a necessity in every case. But again, it, you know, that wasn't necessarily what I had done as part of my college experience. So it was a helpful exercise for me.
Okay. And you're actually the first entrepreneur I've interviewed that's mentioned that you went through the SBA loan program. A lot of my younger students are, you know, they've learned a little bit about it, but they're not all that familiar with it. Would you feel comfortable telling us just a little bit about that process?
Of course. Yeah, I think, you know, the interesting thing is that I saved for years, but I still didn't have enough to, you know, get me to the starting point. So I went to a lender and they were SBA loan backed. So I went through the entire process. It's quite lengthy and it's very, I would say very tedious, but it was worth it. And, you know, part of it is that I was able to get enough working capital to make sure that I felt secure in the marketing and all of the things that, you know, end up being a little bit more discretionary when you're really tight. So that allowed me to continue the momentum and keep, you know, kind of building as we went, and of course, pivoting as we went as well. Now, I will say that the SBA, in my opinion, has a tremendous, you know, system. They are, in a lot of cases, the backbone of small businesses in America. And, you know, I've taken advantage of a lot of the things that they have to offer. So they have a SCORE mentorship program. And as I launched my business, I took advantage of a lot of their volunteers. They're completely volunteer-based program. And a lot of them are retired executives. So they have the business acumen, they have the experience, they can come in and help give a little bit of advice and coaching to help you, you know, kind of tweak things here and there. And so overall, I thought the process was really, you know, something that I would recommend. It's worth it to get over the tedium of the paperwork in order to have access to what I think is a pretty good lifeline to other, you know, experts.
So your SBA actually provided experts there helping you and coaching along.
So it's a national program actually, and it's called SCORE. I think it's an acronym, but it's SCORE, and there are chapters all over the country. And so I was able to find folks in my area that were able to help. But again, it's a really big network to help assist entrepreneurs.
The one thing that I think entrepreneurs always ask, you know, especially with coronavirus right now, things are changing so rapidly. Do you have, you know, a process or techniques to just kind of help you stay kind of on the forefront of everything?
COVID is changing the landscape for almost every business out there. Some, obviously, it's, you know, creating a big surge of, you know, an influx of business for them or changes. Some, it's really going to, you know, cause people to struggle. the restaurant industry has had a very dramatic impact. And I would say, you know, we're really lucky. We have had the mentality of pivoting, of changing, and we've almost changed our business model every single week since COVID launched or COVID started. I mean, it's crazy how intense it has been. It's very grueling. It's frustrating. It's, you know, all of those things. But I do believe we will emerge from COVID better than when we went in, which is unbelievable. And that type of kind of nimbleness and ability to flex here and there, I think is, you know, again, what I'm trying to describe as a very important component for any entrepreneur. Now, the next business that I launched called Fireproof is actually helping a lot of attorneys. So we have the partners in this Fireproof business. It's a firm in Detroit, Michigan. It's the Mike Morris Law Firm. And the head attorney, the man who is the founder of the firm, had his COO, and the two of them wrote a book on the success that they've had over the years. And I will say that law firms do not seem to be as affected through COVID. So interestingly, as you're launching a business and you're trying to look for different markets that might be, you know, willing and open to new possibilities. So we've been able to go after this market and they're very receptive. They are growing or stable. I think, you know, again, there are certain sectors that have had really no impact or they've had a positive impact. So in launching Fireproof, we wanted to be able to help drive growth even further for these law firms. And at some point, I think we will take it to probably dentists, doctors, and maybe even restaurants, believe it or not. So I would say, yes, COVID has affected everyone. Yes, it is, you know, a big impact. I'm hopeful that people can find the positives and be able to pivot like we have with the restaurant or go after markets that are stable or growing like we have with Fireproof.
So kind of a follow-on question, because I know my students are going to ask. You talk about, you know, you need to be able to identify pivoting or when to pivot. What does that process look? Is it intuition? Do you have a methodology for it? Is it some combination of the two?
Yeah, you know, that's a great question. I think when there is a roadblock, when there is something that is causing tension, friction, you know, I think those are the times when it's the easiest. I would say most people react too late. So unfortunately, you know, you find businesses where they say, oh yeah, in hindsight, we should have done something differently. We missed the mark. Our competitor came in and took over our market, or we didn't see that a technological advance was coming until it was too late. So what I try to do through my innovation coaching is really recommend that people take a hard look at their culture in order to foster the type of skills necessary when a pivot is needed. So I'll put this in terms of kind of fitness. I would say most people, when they have a health crisis, say the same thing. Gosh, I wish I would have, stopped smoking earlier. I wish I would have worked out more. I wish I would have eaten healthier. It's too late by the time they get to that point. But the people who can see that that's going to be important for the future are building the skills necessary. They're building the muscles. They're doing the work necessary to set them up for success in the future. So again, this analogy, I think if we use it towards, you know, the necessity to pivot, the innovation necessary for businesses to survive and then thrive, if they build that muscle of creative problem solving, they will be ready to pivot when the moment necessitates. So if they see a competitor doing something, they will turn on a dime. If they see a technological advancement, they'll be able to leverage it instead of having it disrupt them negatively.
That's great. Yeah, investing in people, basically.
That's right.
Yeah, that's awesome. Now, you talked about the pivots. You know, a lot of times people look at it in hindsight. Looking back and with full 2020 hindsight, is there anything that you would have done differently?
Well, that is a great question. I would say, you know, one thing with the restaurant that I have always wanted to do is to be able to kind of ship food all over the country. Mm-hmm. And during COVID, that was obviously something that I think could have been tremendously successful. The problem is I never invested in the research to do the flash freezing to figure out what the shipping costs would be. And had I had that business model in place, I think I would have been, you know, just extraordinarily successful. One of the things in a restaurant, of course, is that you have peaks and valleys in your business. So you have a lunch rush, you have a dinner rush, but there's time before, in the middle, and after when the capacity of your restaurant is, you know, you're not utilizing it to its fullest potential. So if we had that type of a mail order business, we would have been able to make the food, flash freeze it, and utilize those down periods so that we would have been able to have a lot better output during our low periods. And it would have translated to after COVID. Someday when the world goes back to normal, hopefully we would have been able to leverage that, you know, capability. It's still something that's on my mind. I just wish I would have done it sooner. It'll take, you know, a pretty good capital investment to be able to have the equipment to do it. But again, I think at some point it is worth it. And in hindsight, I think it would have really paid dividends during COVID.
You know, is there a message that you have for young ladies out there who are trying to figure out, you know, should I become an entrepreneur or not? What message would you have for them?
Well, I mean, I think it takes, you know, the right kind of attitude. I would say, you know, I think that anyone can be an entrepreneur. I would say, what I have found is that oftentimes those that, you know, may not have the mentors around them are those that might second guess themselves. So if it is something, just like any other walk of life, if it's something that you're interested in, find people that you can do a little bit of research on, start talking to, start understanding what it takes. What is it that makes them successful? Or what is it, you know, what is it that has made people not be successful in their venture? It's the same, in my opinion, if you wanted to learn to horseback ride, right? You'd go and watch people doing it. You'd understand what they do to be successful. If you want to be an entrepreneur, I don't believe that there is any barrier any longer to women. In fact, I think there's a lot of incentives, and I think we have what it takes, you know, in general. So I guess I would say, you know, things like what you're doing, Dr. D, and, you know, bringing together women that can provide some motivation, some inspiration, some real world experience will help people to understand whether or not they have what it takes. And some people at the end of the day might say, you know what? I think I want to do something different. I think I want to be a part of a massive corporation because that is inspiring to me. And that's phenomenal. It's not for everyone. But for those, you know, that have those kind of special abilities to see that, you know, great risk can often lead to great reward, I think, you know, they probably will be very, very empowered to build whatever it is and create whatever it is that they have a passion for. And I do believe that it can be quite, you know, rewarding in the long term.
Let's say someone's interested in the businesses you do, or they'd like to get in touch with you. How could they do that?
Yeah, thank you for asking that. So I have my website that is www.sarafrasca.com. So they can find me there at any point. I'm also on LinkedIn and Facebook and all sorts of, you know, social media places. So anyone that needs anything, they can feel free to reach out right on the website. You know, they can contact me. But yeah, I think, you know, classes like what you're doing, you know, there's lots of great women doing lots of great things out there. So I'm just very hopeful that people will seek out mentors, seek out people that they can, you know, really learn from.